Mr. Pageant is having a program in the library for parents at North Haven. He has purchased brand new hexagon-shaped tables. He wants to know how many parents can sit around a row of tables with their edges touching. The top surface of each table is a hexagon, and the hexagons are arranged in rows of different shapes. Now, that's a lot of words, right? Did we say a lot of words with this problem?
Yeah.
All right. Now, before we even start, I want to pause for a second, and I want us to think about what are some things that we do before we even attempt to solve a problem. All right, so I'm going to give you a few minutes of private think time, and I just want you to think about what are some things that we do in here before we solve a problem. Just take a few minutes to think. Taurus, what do we do?
Underline important words.
All right, we begin by doing what to that problem?
Analyzing.
And when we analyze it, we do what?
We break it apart
so that it can make sense. So that's where we're going to start. But right before we get there, we've also been learning about some words and some things that we can do in the classroom to help us make sense of problems and to help us help each other. So let's take a look at our mathematical interactions, and let's make those connections and reminders. Can someone give me one that you remember that you've been practicing? Renaya, which one do you remember you connect with?
Thinking about my thinking.
Why is that important?
So when you have a time to think about when you have a question.
Okay, because it gives you time to think about, okay, your question. All right, let's see. Let's go to Amaya.
I've been thinking about private thinking time because, like, if you need private thinking times, you can tell your neighbor, say, may I have some private thinking time, please?
Right, because it's very important that we give ourselves time to think about the problem before we jump right into it and start talking and interacting with each other. All right, Jamiria?
The words that I've been practicing on is thinking about my thinking because that reminds me of metacognition.
Okay, and what do you know about metacognition? That's a big word, girl.
That people think when they could think out loud.
Okay, it's kind of like thinking out loud, thinking about what's in your brain. Okay, we'll take two more. We'll take Calicut.
At general question.
What does that mean to you, and why is that important?
It's important to me because genuine means wise, and because if you ask one of your group members a question, you got to be wise.
Okay, and you want to keep it focused on the problem? All right, and we'll take one more from this back group. Let's see, someone who has not. Anicia.
Share my challenges, like, if you need help, you could ask three before you ask the teacher.
Right, and you want to share your challenges because are we always going to get it right the first time?
No.
Even Mrs. Williams, I have to think through and I may have to ask somebody else. And it's okay if we get help from other people. As we're working and as you begin this process, I do want you to keep in mind all of these. And what I'm going to do, Ms. Nakarado, is going to hand it to you because remember filling out a sheet like this? I'm going to go ahead and put it on your desk. Because right before we start the task, I want you to have it to think about all of these interactions as you're working through your task. Because you'll have to write something about it later on. And we always want to keep our minds about how we're interacting with our groups and what we're doing when we're working independently. All right. So we are going to focus up here. And once you already have this paper on your desk. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes of just private think time. And during this time, all I want you to do, Derek, is I want you to look at your problem that Mr. Pageant has presented to us. And I want you in your private think time to underline words that you think is important and words that you think could help you solve this problem. Are we ready?
Yeah.
All right, begin.
Thank you.
Just what do you think is important to solve this problem? Are you thinking about it in your head? Okay. Okay, you should be underlining those important words, finding those math words maybe. What's important to you? Oh, that's a good word. Why did you underline that word? Okay, do you know something about edges? What do you remember about edges? Oh, it's at the end of a shape, and you think that, good. So you connected that math to it. Very good. You have about 30 more seconds. Oh, you underline a range. That's a good one. Why'd you underline a range?
I don't
know. Oh, okay. So it's telling you what it's going to look like. Okay. Yes. Scoot your chair up. Well, you're going to decide what to use right now. Just want to, in this think time, just what words are important. But I'm glad you're thinking. So you might want to write notes on the side, something you already are thinking about what you're going to use to solve. So you might want to write that down. Good job. Okay, have about 7 more seconds. All right. 1, 2, 3, all eyes on me. All right, now that you've had a moment to look through this problem and begin analyzing it by yourself, deciding what words were really important to help you solve the problem, well, now I want you to work in your groups. So when we're working in groups, what do you all use to speak with each other? You use your talking chips. So let's take our talking chips out. You guys have enough over there? Okay, good. Okay, do we all have our talking chips?
Yeah.
You don't? You're getting them? All right. Okay, let me get your attention again. Amaya, you with me? All right, so you're going to use your talking chips to share. Y'all with me, group? You're going to share your thoughts with your group because you could have underlined a word that was important that maybe someone else missed, okay? So you're going to use your talking chips and you're going to begin sharing the words that you underline that you think would help attack this problem. All right, I'll give you about 2 to 3 minutes to do this with your group, and Ms. Nakarado and myself will come around to hear what you're saying to each other. Begin.
Hexagon shape tables because this will shape the tables. How many tells you how many in all? And sit around a row of tables is how many?
Okay, what you underline? What did you underline? Okay, all right. So what do you know about hexagons? Good. So is that something you think is important to solve this? Is that something everybody could use? Or you might want to take your notes on your side of your paper to remind yourself of that. That's good. All right, keep going.
I underline hexagon-shaped tables, so we'll know what shape is the table.
Very good.
I
want to
learn how many,
so
we can learn each table different
shape. Okay. Can you pick one and tell them why you underlined it? Why did you think that was important?
I picked one different shape because it's a different shape than the other.
Oh, so you're going to see some differences. Okay, keep going. Good.
Hexagons are arranged in rows.
Why is knowing the hexagon, why is that important?
Because so you know what shape it is?
Yes.
And how many people can sit at the table, right?
Yes. First, I underline hexagon-shaped tables. And then I underline rows, row of tables. Then I underline edges touching. And then I underline hexagons. And then I underline hexagons are arranged in rows of different shapes.
Have about 10 more seconds. Okay, what did you underline? Did you all sort of underline the same thing?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Andrew, you already... Okay, yeah, you do know. I told you Ms. Patrick was wrong. Clap two times. Clap two times. Half clap. All right, so we've had some private think time to begin doing what to their problem? Breaking it apart and making it make sense to us. And you've also had some time to sort of talk to your group and begin to tell, well, this is what I underlined and why you were sharing ideas. Thumbs up if you found some important math words or some important information that you know you can use to begin solving this problem. Okay? All right, now put your hands down. Well, now you're going to get the opportunity to use it, okay? So we're going to go back over the problem again. Mrs. Williams will read it again. Is that clear? Can you guys see that? All right. So, Mr. Pageant, he's having a program in the library, and he wants to invite our parents up. He's bought some tables, and they're in the shape of a hexagon. And he needs to know how many parents can sit around a table if their edges are touching. I notice a lot of you all underline the word edges. The top surface of each table is a hexagon, and the hexagons are arranged in rows of different patterns. I also heard you all pointing out how the rows were different what?
Shapes.
They were different shapes. Very good. All right. So now, this is all Mrs. Williams is going to give you because you all are the smart ones. I'm giving you a table, all right? Take a moment to look at your table and the information that I've provided you with. Then if you have any questions about that table, raise your hand. You have a question about the table? Yes.
If it's like a hexagon, does only six parents consider
it? I don't know. That's what you're going to figure out for me. But it sounds like your thinking is in the right way. Okay, yes, ma'am. Oh, you all are saying some great things. She said, well, wow, Mrs. Williams, does this have anything to do with input and output? Well, guess what? You're going to tell me. This is all I'm going to give you. You're going to decide how you would go about finding out. I have given you how many tables in a row. What are you going to have to find out? You are going to find out the number of parents in each row. And I've heard some really good things. I've heard some people say, this reminds me of input and output, because we've done some of that before, right? And I've heard some people say, oh, Miss Williams, it's a pattern. I might have patterns. Well, I want you to decide. You're going to decide individually and as a group what you would do to figure out the number of parents in each row. And then let's look down at the bottom. Let's read this together.
What is the rule for the table?
So after you figure out the number of parents who can sit in each row of table, we know that it follows something, and you're going to decide, well, what rule did you have to use to figure out the number of parents of each row? So at this time, the captains, let's put our toolbox on the edge of the tables. Okay. Also, make sure you have your red and green circles. All right, who thinks they're ready to begin solving? Who thinks they can help Mr. Pageant with this problem? All right, so I'm going to allow you all to work together in groups, and you're going to be in teams on the side. I'll pause 1 second before you get started, okay? Make sure you get all of my instruction from me. Now, you decide what you need to use. You don't have to say, well, Mrs. Williams, can I get the markers? Or Mrs. Williams, can I get this? You're going to decide what you need to solve this problem, all right? We're just going to be respectful of each other. We are going to get the things that's needed. And remember, I want to hear you talking. So as I'm coming around, Ms. Nakarado, we may be asking you some leading questions, but you're going to do the thinking. Notice I didn't say, yes, you're going to need this, because you're going to decide individually and as a group. Okay, are there any questions about your task?
No.
All right, you may begin.
Okay.